two people respond. I'll try again. Good morning and happy Sabbath, everyone.
Good morning.
That's better. Thank you. Okay, we're going to begin our praise and worship. We're getting ahead of myself. We're going to begin our divine service. So I invite you to stand as we sing our introit, Welcome in This Place.
Within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgiveth all thine iniquity, who healeth all thy diseases, who redeemeth thy life from destruction, who crowneth thee with loving kindness and tender mercy, who satisfieth thy mouth with good things, so that thy youth is renewed like the eagles. May we pray. Father in heaven, Lord, we just are so thankful to you for your presence in this home today, in this house. We thank you, Lord, that we can come in your sanctuary where you bid us come so that we can worship you, we can bask in your presence, singing and giving praise and glory. As we worship you today, Lord, banish sin and sadness. Over us, Lord, with your Holy Spirit, breathe upon us. Bring healing, health, and strength, Father, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Happy Sabbath to everyone. The privilege is mine to welcome each and every one of you to the house of the Lord today for worship. Have we got any first-time visitors in our midst today? Any first-time visitor? We got one, two.
Amen. Amen and amen.
On behalf of the Balaam Seventh-day Adventist Church, we'd like to welcome you to the Balaam Church today. And as a fellowship and worship with us, we pray that you'll be truly blessed. And we welcome our members. Without you, we would not have a service here today. So we welcome you and we thank God that he has spared your life so that you can be here to worship. So welcome one, welcome all, and may we be truly blessed as we worship today. Our praise team will now do our welcome song for us.
Smile a while and give your face a rest. We're all going to be in an advert for Colgate this morning, okay? Because I want to see those pearly white teeth as we go around and we greet each other. I want you to touch and greet at least 10 people this morning so that everybody can feel welcome. So let's sing Smile a While.
Okay, it's now time for a few brief announcements. But before I do, I was let into a secret by someone. It may be a surprise to those involved, but I'm only doing as I was told. We're all going to celebrate today with one of our brothers who have graduated in the health field. Elder Masanga was graduated. Amen, church. Praise God for Elder Masanga graduating in his health degree. Also, they said that somebody is celebrating a birthday. I don't know if it's this week or today or earlier on next week. Oh, it's today. So normally when someone has a birthday today, I always say it's a double blessing. Because the Sabbath in itself is a blessing, and then you are blessed with your birthday. And I think this person is no other than the pastor's daughter, Helen. Helen, happy birthday to you on behalf of the Balaam Seventh-day Adventist Church. And we hope you have a blessed day today. You're welcome. Okay, Donald's birthday today as well. Pass on our greetings to him and well wishes. Trinity. Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Okay, we wish Trinity a happy birthday as well. 15 today. Oh, they was putting two more years, but you are 13. Okay. Congratulations, and may God continue to bless you as you grow into teenage years. Okay, a few announcements to pay attention to. The first, tomorrow morning, prayer meeting, the last Sunday in the month at 7:30. It's open to everybody. So as long as you're available, you can make your way here for 7:30 tomorrow morning for our end of month prayer meeting. Also, the community services, would like to thank all those who have been donating foodstuff for distribution. We also kindly asking that you continue to bring your food. The basket is out in the foyer. The list is there as to what to bring. And we are kindly asking you, tomorrow, it's our food collection day at the Sainsbury's supermarket on the Balaam High Road. So we are asking for your help. We start from 11 to 5, from the time it opens to the time it closes. But you don't have to come for the whole few hours. If you have an hour to spare, you can come along and help us collect. Because when we collect, we need to come and bring it here and pack it away. And now that the festive season is coming up, a lot of people will be shopping and they will be willing to give. So it can be a great work tomorrow. So if you have the time tomorrow, please come out to help the community services at the Balaam Sainsbury supermarket to collect food donations. Secondly, I would like to mention to you the first reading of a membership transfer in. Sister Halcyon Platt from the SEC to the Balaam Church. Sister Halcyon, are you here today? Can you please stand so that the members can see you? Okay, this is the first reading for Sister Halcyon. She will be transferring her membership to the Balaam Church. Next week we'll have the second reading and the vote. Thank you. Also, for the business meeting next week, as was timed for 5 o'clock, it will not be happening at 5 o'clock, but 4 o'clock. Reason being, there is a big concert happening that same evening, and most of the members will be attending. So we are having the business meeting at 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock instead of 5. Also, the business pack is ready. You can collect your copy at the end of the service. Also, as was mentioned, the soul food, the tickets have been sold out. Although it was free, but whenever you have a free event where food is involved, you have to apply very quickly, otherwise it go quickly. So it totally filled, no more space. And that will be happening on the 3rd as well, after Sabbath, on the 10th of December at 6:30 p.m. So for those of you who are involved, please do not forget. I think this is all the announcement for today. Thank you.
Okay. Okay, we'll just continue. It's now time for our praise and worship. And today's theme is health. And we all know the popular saying, health is wealth. By health, we do not mean absence from physical troubles only, but it is a state of complete mental, physical, and social well-being. The loss of health is a loss of all happiness. Gandhi also says, it is health which is real wealth, and not pieces of gold and silver. Without health, there is no happiness, no peace, and no success. God cares about our health, and he sympathizes when we lose our health. He is the great physician. The first song of our praise session talks about that. It's hymn number 254, The Great Physician Now Is Here. Affects the state of our bodies. We carry around worries and stresses that physically make us ill. The good news is that we don't have to do that. Amen. Psalms 55 verse 22 says, cast your burdens on the Lord and he will sustain you. He will never allow the righteous to be shaken. We can trade our sorrows, our shame, our sickness and our pain, and instead receive the joy of the Lord. We'll sing trade in our sorrows now. Fanny Crosby was America's most prolific hymn writer, and she wrote 8,000 gospel songs and hymns during her lifetime, which spanned nearly a century. She passed away in her 95th year. All of her days, except the first 6 weeks, were spent in blindness. A poorly trained doctor applied a mustard plaster poultice to her eyes when she was only 6 weeks old, rendering her totally blind. However, not even the loss of sight could render defeat to this astoundingly courageous soul. Even in her childhood, she realized she had a special gift. She said often, "I have a jewel, content." When only 9 years of age, she wrote, "Oh, what a happy soul am I, although I cannot see. I am resolved that in this world, contented I will be. How many blessings I enjoy that other people don't. To weep and sigh because I'm blind, I cannot and I won't." Fanny Crosby learned to be content despite her blindness. And I want to end our praise session with a song of assurance written by her. Whatever our situation, whatever the condition of our health, we too can have the assurance that God has promised to be faithful. So we're going to sing Blessed Assurance, and I invite you all to stand as we sing this last song for our praise session.
Jesus.
in his love. This is my story.
This is my story.
Children's story. So as the children come, we're going to sing "He's Got the Whole World in His Hands." He's got the whole.
He's got the whole.
One more time, he's got the whole.
He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands.
Good morning, boys and girls. Okay, well done, Shiloh. Okay, I'm going to tell you a story today, and I'm not going to tell you who the story is about. You're going to have to listen carefully, and at the end, you tell me who the story is about, okay? Right. So, Eunice and Robert, a day like today, they were very happy. Eunice had just given birth to twin girls. She was excited. God had blessed them not just with one baby, but they had two beautiful babies. So they were devout Methodists. So they went to church on Sunday. They didn't go to church on Sabbath like we do. And they grew up their girls in church, and every Sunday they would take them to church and they watched them grow. When they were 9 years old, they both were coming home from school. They were maybe about in year 4 or 5. Who is a 9-year-old? No, they were in year 5, maybe, because that's where 9-year-olds, okay, so they were in year 4 then, all right. So they maybe were in year 4, right. So they were heading home from school, and they decided they weren't going to take the long way around. They were just going to go through the park. So they walked through the common, and when they were going through the common, they were walking with one of their friends, and there was another girl. She just get upset for no reason, and it was something very trivial, something very simple that she shouldn't have gotten upset about, but she did. and she threw a stone. Oh no, and it struck one of the girls right on the nose. Oh, her nose was broken very badly. And as a result of that, yes, because you got bone there and the stone is hard and it was flung with such a force. Yeah, I think it was a big stone. Right. So she fell to the ground. 1 minute. Okay, all right, just listen. We're going to get there in a minute. So she fell to the ground. She was unconscious, meaning she wasn't dead, but she couldn't respond when you talked to her. She didn't know where she was. When she woke up, she was in a store. A kind stranger offered to take her home, but she said, no, I'm okay, I can walk. So she got up to walk home, but she felt really dizzy and faint. So she fell over again, except for her sister and her friend, who struggled, and they took her home. When she went home, she didn't remember anything. For weeks, she lied there in a coma. She was unconscious. Mommy had to do everything for her. She didn't know where she was. They made this giant cot so she could fit, that would fit a 9-year-old. So she was in that cot for a long time, and she didn't know anything. A lot of people thought she would die, but Mommy knew that her little girl would one day again live. So people even came and offered her a nice white gown to bury her in. But Mommy didn't do that, because Mommy, somewhere inside her, she knew that her little girl would live again. So after 3 weeks, she woke up, but she was very weak. Because you know, today medicine is advanced. So when that happened, we would put a tube through the nose, go down to the stomach, and we would feed them through it. But in those days, they didn't have that. So she was very weak and very skinny. She was like a skeleton. But they kept the faith, and she got better slowly. But when she went out to play, because she had her nose was really broken, she couldn't breathe through her nose for 2 years. For two years she had to breathe through her mouth. She couldn't breathe through her nose like we do. Can you believe that? She went back to school. She was very weak. She tried to learn, but it was hard work. And guess what happened when she went back to school? The same girl that threw the stone and broke her nose, they put her to be her mentor so she would look after her, because she was now not able to do things for herself. But do you think she was angry at this girl? No, because when she was sick, she prayed and she asked God to help her to be loving and to be kind to everybody and to even prepare her to die. But she grew, and she got better eventually. And this girl became a big woman, got married, had children of her own, and she wrote loads of books. Now, who is the story I'm talking about?
A girl broke her nose.
Oh, one together. What's the girl's name? What's her
name? Angie White.
Well done. Yes, so the girl in the story was Ellen G. White, and that was the story of her childhood. Had she been alive today, she would be celebrating her birthday. Did you know she was born on the 26th of November, 1827? That's a long time ago. Yes. And she would have been celebrating her birthday today. So when you go home, you can get Mommy and Daddy to read you the story of her life in Life Sketches of Ellen G. White. Okay? All right, ask the question.
What is 100?
No, she would have been 189. Okay. All right. Can I have somebody to pray for me?
Wait.
What's something? Oh, you want to tell me?
She marries someone. I forgot what his name is, but his surname is White.
Okay. Can we have somebody to pray? You gonna pray?
Yeah.
You gonna pray, or you wanted to say something? You want to pray? Okay. So we're going to have
Three.
Pass your hands, guys, and close your eyes. We're
going to
pray.
Dear Jesus, please bless me. Thank you, Lord, for waking us this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Our kind and loving Father, thank you for keeping us through the day. Now, three, please forgive us for our trespasses and let us continue to have a good day. Amen.
Amen. Okay, you can go back to your seats, guys.
Let's sing "He's Got the Whole World" while the children go back.
He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands.
Happy Sabbath, Church.
Happy Sabbath.
In 1984, Jake and his family belonged to an Eastern Coast church in the US. And one Sunday evening, they decided to go to church, and the sermon happened to be on sacrificial offerings. And a special offering was taken. Now, Jake found himself in a situation where he had a $50 note in his pocket and nothing else. But he took a leap of faith and decided to put the $50 bill in the offering basket. Now, this $50 bill was meant to feed the family, his wife and his five kids, for the week. But Jake put the $50 note in the offering basket, hoping that God was going to come through for him. Now, after the service, when they walked into the car park and got to the car, Jake saw the car full of bags of grocery shopping. But Jake locked the car, he rolled the windows, and Jake doesn't have any family living in the area. So he went back into the church and asked the pastor whether the pastor knew something about it. But the pastor did not believe Jake, so he came out with Jake to check whether what Jake was saying was true or not. Now, the pastor saw the shopping in the car, and they tried to figure out how the shopping came into the car. But then another gentleman standing by, called Robert Costa, who was also a pastor, said that, well, men ate the bread of angels. He sent them all the food they could eat. Now, church, you can find this in Psalm 76, 78, I think, verse 12 or 25. Psalm 78, verse 25, where it says that, and it's a contemplation of Asaph. It says that God gave the people of Israel, people like you and I, the food of angels. Amen. Church, the God of Israel is the same God yesterday, today, and tomorrow, and forevermore. So if you did that for Jake and his family, I can assure you that God will come through for you. Amen. Your blessing or what you need from God may not be a grocery shopping or a list of items from the shop. It may be something else, but God nevertheless will come through for you. And I can assure you, brothers and sisters, that if you give with a cheerful heart, it will come back to you, pressed down, shaking together, and running over. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
As we all give unto the Lord.
Okay, as we collect our offering, we are going to sing Just Wanna Thank You. Because we've got so much to thank God for.
Just wanna thank you forever and ever and ever for all you've done for me. Blessings and honor and glory, they all belong to you. Thank you,
wanna thank you.
Just wanna thank you forever and ever and ever for all you've done for me.
Blessings and honor.
Blessings and honor.
And glory.
And glory.
They all
belong to you. Thank you, Jesus, for blessing me.
We'll listen to the musicians as they play.
Just wanna thank you forever
and ever
and ever
and ever,
and ever
for all
you've done for me.
Blessings
and honor and glory,
they all
belong to you. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus, for blessing me.
Thank you, Jesus, one last time.
Thank you, Jesus, for
now time for our season of prayer, and as we prepare ourselves for that, we're going to sing Sweet Hour of Prayer.
Sweet Hour.
welcome to today, day of fellowship and worship. It is said that prayer is talking to God like to a friend. Personally, for me, I say prayer is more than talking to God to a friend, because some things I can't tell my friend, but some you can tell God everything. Wherever possible, let us bow in worship and in adoration to pray. Heavenly Father, which art in heaven, in the name of Jesus we come, knowing in whom we have believed, and we are persuaded that you are able. Father, now, dear Lord, as we pray, may you take our hearts and our minds far away, Lord, from the cares of this world, to your throne where grace does abound. Holy angels, Holy Spirit, we thank you for the work that you are doing in our lives. As we come to fellowship one with another, and we come to worship you, our Creator and our King, we come asking you, dear God, through Jesus Christ, who said, come boldly to the throne of grace. You said, come, let us reason together. Though your sins be as scarlet, you shall make it as white as snow. We acknowledge you as Jehovah Jireh, El Shaddai, Jehovah Nissi. Father, we come asking you to bless every head that is bowing. Just as our faces are different, so our daily needs. Jehovah, we lift up our eyes unto the hills, for whence cometh our help? Our help cometh from the Lord, which made heaven and earth. Father, you have brought us here now, too far to turn back. We pray that you seal our decision of serving you in spirit and in truth. We pray for those who are sick among us, Father. Let your will be done. May we have faith like a mustard seed that we can say to the sickness or whatever, get thee behind. Father God, in the name of Jesus, I come praying for every young person. I pray, Lord Jesus, for our children that are out there. Lord, when we look around, we can see, we can feel. Nature in itself tells us that your coming is soon. Lord, our children are out in the world. We pray in the name of Jesus that you give them a Damascus experience. Whatever it takes to save our children, dear God, please bring them in before it is too late. Father God, we pray for every mother, every father, every child, every boy, every girl. Seal all of us all over the world. All your children that will be standing on the sea and glass, the number that will be numberless, we pray, dear God, that you will seal us for eternity. A special prayer, Father, I want to pray for the four musicians that is over there. Lord Jesus, you said music is a part of worship. Father, when we get to heaven, we will sing the songs of Moses and the Lamb. We will have musical instruments. I want to present Joseph into your hands. Father, take this boy and mold him and fashion him like Jesus. I want to take Camden in your hands, Father. I pray you pour out a double portion of your Holy Spirit upon him. I pray for Cassell, in the name of Jesus, Father, I pray that you will let this boy be a shining light. May he have favor with God and man. Lord, I pray for Joel, that as he touch music instruments, that the lives will touch to Jesus. Somebody, some young man will see these four young men and praise God and glorify them. Lord, remove self in them and let them worship you in spirit and in truth. I thank you, Lord, for a church family. Where else can we be, Father, than in the house of God? Let your will be done, Father. I pray for the offering at this moment. May it go into the hands of spiritual, godly men that will do your work, and that your coming will be very sure. Jesus, anoint us and bless us. May the love of God and may the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. And I just want to say thank you for the trials and the troubles that comes our way, that purifies us and straightens us for eternity. Father, we confess our sins, for we know sin does not have no place in you. And as we confess our sin and we live a godly life, people will run to you and Jesus will come as soon as possible. Thank you and we praise you and we worship you for who you are. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
In seasons of distress and grief, my soul has often found relief and oft escaped the
reading will be taken from Deuteronomy chapter 7, reading verses 6 to 15, and I'll be reading from the King James Version. I'll ask us to read responsively. I would read verse 6 and you read verse 7 and so on. Okay? Give you a chance to find that. Deuteronomy chapter 7, reading verses 6 to 15. For thou art an holy people unto the Lord thy God. The Lord thy God has chosen thee to be a special people unto him, unto himself, above all people that are upon the face of the earth. But because the Lord loved you, and because he would keep the oath which he had sworn, the Lord brought you unto your fathers, had the Lord brought you out with a mighty hand, and redeemed you out of the house of bondmen, from the hand of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. And repaired them that hate him to their face, to destroy them. He will not be slack to him that hateth him. He will repay him to his face. Wherefore it shall come to pass, if ye hearken to these judgments and keep and do them, that the Lord thy God shall keep unto thee the covenant and the mercy which he sware unto thy fathers. Thou shalt be blessed above all people. There shall not be male or female barren among you or among your cattle. Should we read the verse 15 together, please? And the Lord will take away from thee all sickness and will put none of the evil diseases of Egypt which thou knowest upon thee, but will lay them up, all them that hate thee. May the Lord bless the reading of his holy word. Amen.
I would also like to take this opportunity to welcome a few of the visitors that have come in after our welcome. We did our welcome. So for those of you who have not yet been welcomed, we want to welcome you in a special way for joining us at the Balaam Church for worship today. I just want to make special mention of my brothers from the Fulham Church, the Bartholomew Brothers. Welcome to Balaam. It's nice to have you visiting today. God bless you as you worship with us today. Our speaker today was to be our pastor, but unfortunately he's not here because of the flu. So let us remember him in our prayers. But we have an appointed Joseph Clem, amen, who had answered the call to step in. Amen. And so he will bring to us the message for today. But before he does, we'll have our meditation from Emma.
Morning in the morning, in the afternoon time. Amen. Thank you, Emma, for this wonderful song. All things are possible when we call on Jesus. Okay. So the theme for today is health. I must apologize. As you know, I'm not Pastor Bui, and even though I asked him for what was in his mind to present, so he sent me the text, I will say, the sermon, but you know, my style is not his style. But however, I try to combine, because I'm more an expositor than a topical preacher. But however, I know God wants us to be united in the concept of what is health and what is Adventism. So I hope to give justice to his thoughts as well. And if he's watching us, happy Sabbath, Pastor, and speed recovery. Okay, so I know this week was, the Chancellor autumn statement. Then in America, at work, people do talk, and you could feel the pressure of the uncertainty. And then you had Brexit, you had the presidential election in America. And when I checked the statistic in terms of the American Psychological Association, I found out that 52% of adults say that the election increased their stresses, so was a significant factor for stress. So 52% of the adults. And then regarding those on social media, 38%, whether adult or youth, said political topic or religious topic increase their stress level. So there was the Thanksgiving, there was the Black Friday, so I hope everybody tend to be more relaxed. But in case you are not, I look for the first slide. I give you a thought of one of my favorite author to give you some reassurance, because God, as disciple of Christ, we have no fear for the future. It will be difficult, but we should not. It will be challenging, but especially 2017. But we should not be fearful, I will say. Christ has made us know that in store for us, he holds the future. Okay? So if I could have the first slide, it's just a thought that keeps me going as well. So I love the song. When we pray to Jesus, we call on Jesus, all things as possible. But then it says, in the annal of human history, the growth of nation, the rise and fall of empires appear as dependent on the will and prowess of man, or woman, if you prefer. The shaping of events seems to a great degree to be determined by his power, ambition, or caprice. But in the word of God, the curtain is drawn aside, and we behold, behind, above, and through all the play and contemplate of human interests and power and passions, the agency of the all-merciful one, silently, patiently working out the counsel of his own will. God is in control. Okay, let us pray. Heavenly Father, once again, I want to thank you for life. Thank you for this opportunity to meditate upon your words. Bless everyone here present and those online as well. Bless us all, we pray in Jesus' name, amen. So our prophetic heritage and health, thank you, it was a bit far, but yeah. So God, we'll start first with the Bible, because Adventists, we're the people of the book, we're the people of the Bible, and we tend to find our strength in the Bible. So Deuteronomy 7, the scripture reading, the message there is obedience to God lead to blessing. Obedience fruits individual and corporate health and prosperity. So God wants us to have a life of obedience. It could be challenging. You could reason with him, because he says, let us reason together. but he wants us to prosper physically, mentally, spiritually. So it says, therefore, you shall keep the commandment, the statutes, and the judgment which I command you today to observe them. You shall be blessed above all people. There shall not be a male or female barren among you or among your livestock, and the Lord will take away from you all sickness. So, yes, for those who were shepherds or nomadic life, yes, but we could learn into, if you don't have a cattle, but you could, in whatever business you involve into, you'll prosper. There will be ups and downs because you're under attack as well, but your mindset is to prosper. In Psalm 103, verse 1 to 5, my favorite is verse 3, but we could read, you have blessed the Lord, O my soul, who heals all your diseases and satisfies with good things, or satisfies you with good things. I like to say, who forgives your transgresses and heal your sicknesses. You have Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 to 8. Trust, lean not, acknowledge health to your health, your flesh, and strength to your bone. 3 John chapter 2. I hope all is well with you and that you are healthy in body as you are strong in spirit. Healing, health, and wholeness is our heritage from God, not sickness, suffering, and sadness. But we know we're part of a great controversy, a fight between good and evil. And whether or not we want, we're part of it in that conflict. Since because of Adam and Eve, our first parents, they decided to believe more in Lucifer, or who became Satan, the adversary, and then they trust him more. So God had a plan. As you know, Genesis 3:15 was the promise that God say, I will put enmity. And then John 3:16 was the fulfillment of that promise, that for God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whosoever believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. So God's, our heritage is to have a proper health, and we're not only talking about physical, but mental and spiritual health, and to prosper. So these principles have come to us from scriptures, from prophets, like one of my favorite writer and Ellen G. White, and then society as well, learn from experiences, observation. So from the Bible, we've learned what God intended for us to have. And then through, as he developed the movement, the Adventist movement, he also give us direction and use prophets through the Bible, use also Helen White. For those who may not know or you're not familiar with Adventism, when the movement, the Millerite movement was taking place, there was the Millerite, because of William Miller, he preached that the sanctuary will be cleansed based on his interpretation of Daniel, the book of Daniel, and then he told that the sanctuary that was mentioning was the earth. So he projected by 1843, then they changed the date to 1844, he predicted that Jesus would come. But as the Bible says, you should not put any date. But at least something did take place. The interpretation, then they study again. They realized that, no, the sanctuary was not the earth, but heaven. So there was cleansing in heaven. Some may argue and say, but how come sin was in the earth? But if you reflect, really, sin started in heaven. So that's why there was that cleansing taking place. So then from that, you had what we call the great disappointment. People were, some lose their job because they were expecting Jesus. They change their ways, they give away everything. So when Jesus did not come, you had panic, you had stress, you had distress. Some end up sometime in hospital, or they were being kind of ridiculed by others. But a faithful few keep on trusting God. And through that faithful few, God spoke and directed. And you have Ellen White. Before her was Azen Foss, but he didn't. He believed the message, but in the same time, what took place was he got pride kind of way. So, and then you had William Foy, was more like a mulatto, and sometimes to preach in a in an assembly or audience that are majority white was a challenge, and so he was afraid. But then God chose Ellen Harmon, and she became, I mean, after she married James White, she was known as Ellen White or Ellen G. White. So the health message and Adventism is mainly implicated in her teaching as well, but from the Bible. So the inclusion of health as a core component of the Adventist message on account of the prophecies of Sister White bring Adventism to a unique type of movement, because people were expecting Christ's return, but in the same time they were not really keen into lifestyle, healthy lifestyle. For example, even for her, when she got the message about not eating meat or reducing on certain flesh food or certain things, she said, no, are you sure? Or, yeah, because for them in those days was a few vegetables and a big piece of meat or something like that. So, yeah, so it was a challenge. And but they keep on continuing understanding the message and they were able to progress and understand that, yes, even though the time, the technology of the time, if I could have the next slide, the doctors of the time, yeah, do you have pictures first? Yeah. Doctors in the time, this was just after her death, but it was still the philosophy of the time. People believe in if you were sick, there were some issues with your blood, so sometimes they will remove some of your blood to kind of, you have the philosophy from the Greek, when you have phlegmatic, being sanguine, being phlegmatic, or other, there are four types, I keep forgetting, choleric, so there were that element of blood issues, yeah, thanks. So they will kind of remove some blood and ask you to rest. And also if you suffer from maybe cough, they will tell you, have a cigarette. Nowadays we laugh, but the one before, just to let you know. So even physician will tell you, yeah, have a cigarette. So there was this one, this commercial was saying, if you do have two of, this one is less irritating, so you could smoke. Then there was, but this is banned since, for example, even in the UK, 2003, no more commercial of that sort. So they were using also children to have the commercial for mommy, to have smoking as a friendly activity. And so regarding alcohol use, even for commercial for cars, why not have a bar in your front, you know, because traffic jam, you need some time, you may feel thirsty, have something to drink. So this was there. And then, yeah, in the time, now we know the danger of too much sugar. But in those days, yeah, for example, 7-Up was commercial involving children as well. So it's no longer, And so in the desire of Adventism to present the message, there were conflicts. But however, having those messages from God, they were ahead of their time. And yeah, if we could have the writing, I know it's a long writing, but I like, because I prefer speak and show you as well evidence, because Okay, I'm from an 80s background, so I had to research on all religion. When I start to become spiritual, I will say, I had to research. And Adventism, I had queries, but as I researched and God led me to this understanding, yes, so, but that's the way. And maybe some of you, you may have question and wondering. So while working against gluttony or intemperance, we must recognize the condition to which the human family is subjected. God has made provision for those who live in the different countries of the world. Those who desire to be co-workers with God must consider carefully before they specify just what food should and should not be eaten. We are to be brought into connection with the masses. Should health reform in its most extreme form be taught to those whose circumstances forbid its adoption, more harm than good would be done. As I preach the gospel to the poor, I'm instructed to tell them to eat that food which is most nourishing. I cannot say to them, you must not eat eggs or milk or cream. You must use no butter in the preparation of food. The gospel must be preached to the poor, but the time, yeah. So there were some struggling, but I have to give you the context because I know in Adventism, when I first joined, first I was a vegetarian. So it was not an issue to me to be an Adventist. I know being a vegetarian is not a test of fellowship. I know some people tend to have this approach, but it's part of the ideal, okay? But what she was saying is as you preach the gospel or as you preach the message that God gives us, you have to look into what is most nourishing element or diet in wherever you go. So sometimes she would say, some in abstaining from milk, egg, and butter have failed to supply the system with proper nourishment, and as a consequence have become weak and unable to work. Thus, health reform is brought into disrepute. The work that we have tried to build up solidly is confused with strength things that God has not required, and the energy of the church are crippled. But God will interfere to prevent the result of their too strenuous ideas. The gospel is to harmonize the sinful race. It is to bring the rich and poor together at the feet of Jesus. In other words, we need to find the balance in whatever we do. Some may not become vegan or vegetarian, but it's not a sin not to. Even some people, I met people who say in Adventism that yes, yeah, it's like a sin to eat meat, but it's not written in the Bible. God presented us with the ideal. The ideal is to reduce on certain consumption of certain and develop a vegetarian diet or even vegan. But however, you have to be to use common sense and be balanced in things. So you have this. So there is that desire of God to have a people which will be in full potential. And this includes the way we think, the way we eat, the way we do things. So there is that wholeness. Okay? The slides, sorry, if you still have them. Yeah. So the time will come when we may have to discard some of the article of diet we now use, such as milk and cream and egg, but it is not necessary to bring upon ourselves the perplexity by premature and extreme restriction. Wait until the circumstances demand it and the Lord prepares the way for it. We do not mark out any precise line to be followed in diet, but we do say that in countries where there are fruits, grain, and nuts in abundance, flesh food is not the right food for God's people. So then she added almost immediately, we are not to make the use of flesh food a test of fellowship. And I had to look for the context of things, because when she talked about milk and those things, I found a doctor statement from that time. It says, the cows of the 16th Street Distillery Stable were found on examination by the health officer of New York in horrible condition. Their ears were full of sores, their eyes ran rheum, their tongues were thickened and the edges raw. Their nostrils were granderous, their udders had externally large corroding ulcers, and inside the gland were stopped by the gargot, while on their bodies in various places were large sores of different size, all betokening highly inflammatory condition, so affected were the strength and health of some of the animals that when lying down they had to be lifted up, and when up had to be held up by straps passing under the body just behind the forelegs. Yet their milk on subjection to chemical analysis showed no morbid or poisonous constituent and differed only in the slight degree from the milk of healthy cows. So the milk was declared good and the stables were whitewashed, but who among thoughtful people believes the milk to be healthy? Chemistry is not omnipotent. What the laboratory fails to find, the stomach of a child can find, and so swill milk, used as a beverage or as food by children, as its poison distilled into their body till health is lost. And this is Dr. J.C. Jackson, MD, quoted in How to Live, number one, page 2122. So nowadays we have better, I will say, treatment of animals, but there may come a time when also you still have, because of money, and you have issues that, for example, there was a case when you wanted whatever is written on the package doesn't mean it's what is in the package. So let us be open-minded, but also be vigilant. And so God wants us to be vigilant in what we eat, what we exercise, what we do. So I think those revelations was important to develop that movement and say, in order to preach the gospel, in order to know that Jesus is coming soon, yes, you also need to be in good health and prosper. So people who may not believe in you may see that the way you live brings some question. And what was quite thought-provoking is that even by her and God informing the church, that movement, people were questioning, and there was even a doctor who, on certain statement, for example, she was saying in 1903, the influence of the mind on the body as well as the body on the mind should be emphasized. The electric power of the brain promoted by mental activity vitalize the whole system and is thus an invaluable aid in resisting disease. This should be made plain. The power of the will and the importance of self-control, both in the preservation and in the recovery of health, the depressing and even ruinous effect of anger, discontent, selfishness, or impurity, and on the other hand, the marvelous life-giving power to be found in cheerfulness, unselfishness, gratitude should also be shown. So, yes, we believe in the Bible, but sometimes we can't smile, or we, what to say? You know, you. I could say it's, let's say you, vous avez une vie difficile. Yeah, so that was French to say, like you appear having like a difficult life. And so, it's important to, yes, you gain the spiritual, but the spiritual should transform you as well. So God wants us to be and then to do. So she even mentioned about prenatal influences from 1865 to her last years. She emphasized the implication of if the mother is properly treated or things she say, Ellen White emphasized the various facets of prenatal influences. Yet not until the 1950s was this concept given credibility in scientific circles. Since then, a tidal wave of concurrence has flooded the medical world. So in 1865, she wrote, the irritability, nervousness, and despondency manifested by the mother will mark the character of her child. In past generations, if mothers had informed themselves in regard to the laws of their being, they would have understood that their constitutional strength, as well as the tone of their morals and their mental faculties, would in great measure be represented in their offspring. And then Ashley Motagu, in 1954, so way back, later, I will say, wrote, there is now sufficient evidence from many sources to indicate that the unborn child can be variously affected by physical changes in the mother, and that although a woman cannot mark her baby by seeing something unpleasant before he is born, nor mark him a poet by reading, Kit and Shelley, during her pregnancy, there are ways in which she definitely can influence his behavior pattern. It is largely up to her and to those surrounding her during her pregnancy whether an infant will be born a happy, healthy, sweet-tempered individual or an ill-adjusted neurotic. So 1865, making a statement, it's only 1954 that now sociologists or behaviorists started to come in line. So we were ahead of time, of her time. So what I was saying, Dr. McKay, who wanted to find out more about Adventism, was given some review and herald, and as well as some counsel on diet and nutrition. And then other members of his medical team called that nonsense, but he said, I simply cannot accept that explanation. It creates a much bigger problem than it resolves. The accusation was that Ellen White probably may have collected some information from the medical world of her time and then created a kind of book to put that. But his observation after reading some of her books, he said, this explanation will create a much bigger problem than it resolves. If she merely copied her contemporaries, how did she know which ideas to borrow and which to reject? Out of the bewildering array of theories and health teaching current in the 19th century, most were quite irrational and have now been repudiated. She would have had to be a most amazing person with knowledge beyond her time in order to do this successfully. So that was his answer to the accusation. So, and then you had recently, as I remember, with the AYS, or Adventist Youth Society in Balaam, and Public Affairs and Religious Liberty, we presented the Adventist blueprint some time ago. When people were doing research regarding the Adventists, why the Adventists live longer in certain parts of the world, but there were four type of people. You have a group, a community in Italy, another community in Japan, and I think two in America were living longer. But prior to that research, where you could Google, it's called the blueprint. It's a scientist who wanted to find out why. But prior to his research, there was one already done in 1974, but he wanted to replicate that. So the Adventist Incident Study in 1974 sent to 350 Adventist households in California. This questionnaire enumerated 348 variables covering demographic, socioeconomic, and religious belief and practice characteristics. So family and personal medical histories, nutritional, drug use, and exercise pattern. So from that, you had also Okay, the result continued to bear out the positive health benefit of the Adventist health message set forth by Ellen White a century ago. But in Europe, European studies confirm these two Adventist studies. A Norwegian 17-year study covering all Adventists in that country, in Norway, in 1981, that Norwegian Adventists enjoy about the same benefit as California Adventists. The study confirmed the observation that neither social groups nor geographic selection explain the health advantage observed among Norwegian Seventh-day Adventists, and that the total lifestyle generally advocated and followed by Seventh-day Adventists explain the observed result. So in 1982, Denmark Cancer Registration Office in Copenhagen reported as well, after a 35-year study, that only 1 in 10 Adventists developed cancer, whereas the rate for the Danish population was 1 in 4 during the same period. So the Adventists studied in the investigation sustained far less risk of developing cancer than the average person. Their risk was 70 to 80% less than that of the general Danish population. And you have other studies with the Dutch, but I don't want to burden you with studies. But God indeed wants his followers to be healthy. And people will question you because they want to know why you're not behaving this way, why you're not eating this way. So yes, that's also a way to preach, I will say. So her contribution to an advanced understanding of health and disease may be attributed to these factors. So insight received through vision, her spirit-directed ability to perceive what was in harmony with those insights from the maze of current opinion, and thirdly, a governing principle of the great controversy theme that place health matters within the context of a person's spiritual motivation, commitment, and preparation for the advent or the return of Christ. So psychologically, it could not have been otherwise. It was the method of Jesus. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. So gradually God will give us more knowledge of certain things, but you could see his hand, his desire for us to grow, to understand. When I joined the Adventists, I had to research because, you know, for me at that time, religion was something for those in need or not the intellectual, I will say, but at least I've learned better. That was atheism. So there is also that element. And yeah, and then through research, through prayer, and then so atheism also, I could define it as a sort of religion as well. But yeah, so at least, yes, there is that desire that you could sense that God desires us to be healthy, to be ahead of things, but also he wants us to keep common sense and balance in our approach towards other people. Because sometimes as I met people, it's even this week I receive a phone call from someone from a different who's having contact with a different religion. Because I'm online, I will not mention, but I could speak to you after. But they said to me, "You're a Seventh-day Adventist. There are people who want to come to our religion just to befriend, but in their mind is to change us. And so we have a few names and they're not welcome." So it's important for us to be ourselves and if you want to befriend with someone, be true about friendship. Don't try to befriend because of something else. It's because you're breaking trust. So it's important for us as we preach the gospel, as we mingle with people, we are sincere in our interaction with them. So that's important. So yes, so yeah. So yeah. So I will, in conclusion, because I see time going. So as I say, health and wholeness. So modern application, Pastor wanted to have that element of celebration. So celebration, living life to the full. So health by choice, not by chance. So you decide what you eat, how you want to. It's not just the eating, it's because you could eat nicely nourishing food, but maybe you're lacking exercises. For example, me, my wife keep telling me, you need to lose weight, so I plan to do that. And then, but sometimes we're so busy. But however, I've learned that, no, temperance is also managing your time. So you have this, there is food, but there is also managing your time, having sleep, rest, exercising as well. So it's not just the food. It's about also how to think about when problem come and challenging come. How do you, because I tell my colleagues sometimes, focus on what you can control and let go what you cannot control. Because worrying will not change the situation. But you could see what can you do in that particular situation, what can you control, and then address it. And if you cannot, let it go. And then give time to time. So, please, it's simple. Focus on what you can control. Let go what you cannot. So, celebration. Health by choice, not by chance. So, Isaiah chapter 1, verse, you could take notes. We won't go into it. But 18 to 19, come, let us reason, willing and obedient. Eat good of the land, yeah? So God made that promise. What you sow, you will reap. So C is for choice. So if you have celebration, so C for choice. E, exercise. So from heart, lungs, brain, exercise, rejuvenate. So even she had, even Sister Y had some conflict, when, especially when her husband was ill, had a terrible stroke. But then the doctors of the time say, no, he need to rest. And so she agree on certain elements, but not just to sleep and rest. He need to do some activities. Because now we know about brain plasticity, when you have neurons trying to reconnect. So during a stroke, you have a breaking of that. But then through practice, making sure that they, even the, if it's the upper limb who's not connected or not functioning, so you could do some exercises with your arm that is not responding. So it gives messages to the brain. It's, you have sensation. You look at your arm. You look at things. So there is that. We don't know everything about the brain. So, but at least we know certain things. And what we have, we could build upon. So, not to neglect exercises. So E for exercise, then L for liquid, especially water. So sometimes my colleague will say, oh, you're drinking water, and I say, yeah, I'm refilling. And they say, and then I tend to tell them, yeah, water is the strongest drink. So they laugh and wondering why, because they prefer vodka or they prefer something else. So I say, yes, it carry boats. Yeah, it's the strongest water. That's the joke. But at the same time, yes, it's food for thought. But yeah, so liquid, especially water. Every system of body needs water. And I'm married this morning, talk about that. E for environment, so celebration. So C-E-L-E, environment, death of all bees, end of life. This week I was in another religion setting where they were looking into environmental issues, and they wanted to find ways to. So at least what I love about Balaam Church is that we kind of focus on making sure that we have recycling bins and thing. For them was an issue. They could do it personally in their own house, but when come community gathering, they're not that environmental focus. So at least we talk. But then it came to mind even when I opened the bulletin this morning and say cluttering in Balaam. So I say we need, As spiritual being, we also need to exercise this element of environmental issue, and our church or our vicinity should not be in the situation of cluttering. So, and it's not just leave it to others, because I remember when I joined the Adventist church as a youth, I was 16, and the friend I was going out with for a pizza or something like that, usually they will tell me, the Adventist friend, they will say, but why do you take the box and put it in the bin? And I say, yes, because it's about the environment. And then they say, no, but if you do that, those who work to clean the streets will not have a job. And I say, no, that's not my thinking. I could start small. And then, as I grew up, I could say, yeah, they will have less work, but they still have the work, but you don't have to burden them. So, and sometimes the mentality continues, because in church activities, sometimes people leave it for the deacon or deaconesses, and we have to bear in mind it's a community action, is everyone involved. So, yeah. And then in that meeting I had, they, for example, they were on the element of not giving. I don't know if Balaam, we could do that, but in activities or fellowship, we're not using plastic cup, or you're using glass cup or glasses. So, but for them, they say glasses are better than plastic, because plastic you have to throw. Or you could reuse, but no, they didn't want to. So at least there was some thought in that. And so you have groups who want to help the environmental, because nowadays you have so many conflict in the earth, and conflict are sometimes due for, you heard of economic migration, but there are also climatic or climate migration, when people have no longer have water and they migrate to other places. And this creates tension within a country, and then you have civil war. So then you have, so we continue. So E, so environment. B, belief, faith in God. R is for rest. And T is for temperance. And I is for integrity. So we need to be honest in our action, responsible, accountable. And who walks uprightly and works righteousness and speak the truth in his heart, that's integrity. O for optimism, let us be positive thinking, talking. Sometimes we think in advance, but the negative way. So we need to learn to say, unless this happens, I will address it. But why should I think ahead negative thought? I mean, I know some people will say, push the thought away. Me, my approach is always let it come and address it. So you could address it and see what is real than what is not real. So, yeah, and the N for celebration, nutrition. You are what you eat. And then S, social support. It's important to have a network and support each other. So my appeal, or pastor's appeal, is the kingdom of God came and still comes through the healing power of God. The instruction and promises of on health bring about this heritage. Are you experiencing the healing of God? Are you experiencing the health, wholeness of your life as purposed by God? And claim your heritage. Commit to the principle of health in scripture and in the prophecies as well. Is there someone in need of healing? We could pray, but also before you come and for us to pray, if you have a particular prayer request, I will pray for you. But there is, in the last slide, I think, because some people sometimes ask me, in Adventism, why you don't have miracle or things like that? And then when I was doing my research, it's a slide on how Satan work, or how, yeah. Yeah, so I am instructed to say that in the future, great watchfulness will be needed. There is to be among God's people no spiritual stupidity, that's her word, sorry. Evil spirits are actively engaged in seeking to control the mind of human beings. Men are binding up in bundles ready to be consumed by the fires of the last days. Those who discard Christ and his righteousness will accept the sophistry that is flooding the world. Next. Christians have to be sober and vigilant, steadfastly resisting their adversary, the devil, who is going about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Men under the influence of evil spirits will work miracles. They will make people sick by casting their spell upon them and will then remove the spell, leading others to say that those who were sick have been miraculously healed. This Satan has done again and again. And I think the following, we need not be deceived. Wonderful scene with which Satan will be closely connected will soon take place. God's word declares that Satan will work miracles. He will make people sick and then will suddenly remove from them his satanic power. They will then be regarded as ill. These works of apparent healing will bring Seventh-day Adventists to the test. Many who have had great light will fail to walk in the light because they have not become one with Christ. It doesn't say that a miracle will not happen among Adventists, but sometimes because we have that health reform and message, you will regain your health. You'll be in tune with what God's plan. But in the future, or even started already, there are groups who do miracles, and sometimes the plan is that through the miracle you will be deceived, and through this deception you will run away from God's principle. So God also warned us of this. Okay, so we shall sing. Yeah, trust and obey. And then those of you who want a special prayer after the first stanza, I'll pray, and then we'll be close.
Okay, when we walk with the Lord.
When we walk with
Elf Phil stand.
Heavenly Father, once again we want to thank you for your love toward us and towards everyone who want to come to you, Lord. At this time, I present those who came for a special prayer, Lord. I want you to bless them. I base my prayer on Psalm 103 and verse 3, say, you are the one who forgive our trespasses and heal our sicknesses. Lord, I present them to you. Touch them, bless them, make them sense your presence, Lord, and touch their own families as well, wherever they are, Lord. In a special way, Lord, do for them more beyond what they could even think of. I pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Okay, we'll sing verses 2, 3, and 4, then we'll have the benediction, and we'll sing verse 5 as the platform party leave.
not a burden we bear, not a sorrow we share, not a toil he doth quickly repair, not a grief nor a loss, not a frown nor a cross, but is blessed if we trust and
is provided, so feel free to stay and fellowship. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, once again, we want to thank you for life. Thank you for understanding that you love us. You love us in the way that we cannot do anything for you to love us more or anything for you to love us less, Lord. We thank you for your love. Lord, we thank you for this message in which you tell us we want us to prosper in our health, physical health, mental health, spiritual health. Help us to trust and obey. It's a challenge because sometimes we so used to do things the way we used to do. So, Lord, help us to understand and slowly change our ways. Bless us all. Guide us. Keep us faithful. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Okay, we'll sing verse 5 as the platform party leave.
Then in fellowship sweet, we will sing.
Seated. Have a wonderful rest of the Sabbath and enjoy your day.